Monterey, an imprint of Octopus Publishing Group Limited, presents Error of Judgment, The Truth About the Birmingham Bombings, written by Chris Mullin and read by Chris Mullin and Leighton Pugh. To Hugh Callahan, Patrick Hill, Jerry Hunter, Richard McElkenny, Billy Power, Johnny Walker and their families, and to all the other victims of the Birmingham pub bombings. Although I and others saw Mr. Mullin as an irrelevance and an irritation at the time, we were all proved wrong, and he was proved right. Geoffrey Deere, West Midlands Chief Constable, 1985 to 1990.
Preface. On November the 21st, 1974, the IRA placed bombs in two Birmingham pubs, the Mulberry Bush and the Tavern in the Town. They exploded, killing 21 people and inflicting life-changing injuries on many others. The bombs were aimed not at the pubs, but at the buildings they occupied. The Tavern was underneath the New Street offices of the Inland Revenue, and the Mulberry Bush was in the base of the Rotunda, a local landmark. There was a warning, but it came too late, and the bombs detonated before the pubs could be evacuated. Several hours after the explosions, five men, all Birmingham residents, were arrested in Morecambe as they got off the train which connected with the ferry to Belfast. A sixth man was arrested at his home in Birmingham the following day. After 3 days and nights in the custody of the West Midlands Police, four of the six had signed confessions, admitting to having planted the bombs, and two were said to have tested positive for having recently handled explosive. They were tried at Lancaster in the summer of 1975, found guilty, and sentenced to 21 life sentences apiece. Had the death penalty still been in force, they would have hanged. The case would turn out to be one of the biggest miscarriages of justice in British legal history. Even now, 50 years after the event, the ripples spread outward. My friend Peter Chippendale, who reported the trial for The Guardian, was the first to draw my attention to the case. He remarked to me at the time that he thought the six men were innocent. He had reached this conclusion solely on the basis of his attendance at the trial and from talking to relatives of some of the convicted men. David Brazil, a journalist with the Irish Press, reached the same conclusion. Among the many journalists who covered the trial, Chippendale and Brazil were alone in realising there was more to this story than met the eye. Although from that moment onwards I kept an eye on the case as it wound its way through the courts, I was in no position to do much about it. In the early 1980s, the publisher, Carmen Khalil, commissioned me to write a book on the subject. Even then, however, I lacked the resources to conduct a proper investigation. It was not until 1985, when I persuaded my friend Ray Fitzwalter, editor of the Granada television documentary programme World in Action, to employ me to research the case, that we were able to make progress. My Granada colleagues and I made three prime-time documentaries. The first destroyed the forensic evidence. The second blew a hole in the confession evidence, and the third consisted of an interview with one of the actual bombers. I had realised from the outset that merely discrediting the case against the convicted men would not prove their innocence, only that the case against them was weak. To prove innocence, I would have to track down the actual bombers and persuade them to own up in sufficient detail as to make it impossible for those in authority to go on arguing that the real culprits were in custody. This is what I set out to do. By a process of painstaking detective work, I tracked down the four bombers. They each owned up to involvement in the IRA's West Midlands bombing campaign, but only two admitted to their role in the pub bombings. In previous editions, they are identified only by letters of the alphabet. I am now able to name three of the four. Two are dead, and one, who so far admits only to having been collectively responsible for the atrocity, is living openly in Dublin. Error of Judgement was first published in July 1986 and received a mixed reception. A book that could put him in prison. Mr. Mullin is either a liar or a hypocrite, opined a reviewer in the Sunday Express. No one, however, alleged that my claim to trace the bombers was false. With honourable exceptions, Birmingham as a whole was in denial. The news editor of the Birmingham Post claimed never even to have heard the suggestion that the wrong people had been convicted. The city's main bookshop displayed just two copies on a shelf labelled Irish Interest. The regional BBC television channel declined to address the subject, even though it was leading the bulletins on their rival Central Television. When I rang the news desk to find out why, a woman replied sniffily, "We don't have space to review every new book." In June 1987, I was elected to Parliament, which gave me a new platform from which to pursue the case. I could now confront directly those in charge of the criminal justice system, and I took every opportunity to do so. The Devon and Cornwall police were eventually asked to conduct an independent inquiry into the evidence unearthed by Granada Television, and in due course, the Home Secretary, Douglas Hurd, referred the case back to the Court of Appeal. The appeal was at that time the longest in British legal history. Lord Lane, the Lord Chief Justice, presided, and in due course, he dismissed it with contempt. "The longer this case has gone on," he said, "the more convinced this court has become that the verdict of the jury was correct." Words he would live to regret. Gradually, however, more stones began to fall from the arch. In August 1989, West Midlands Chief Constable Geoffrey Deer was forced to disband the notorious regional crime squad following a growing list of scandals, many involving intimidation and false confessions. In at least two cases, officers were alleged to have induced a confession by holding a plastic bag over the suspect's head. Several prominent members of the squad had also been involved in the pub bombings investigation 15 years earlier. The implications were obvious. 3 months later, the four people convicted of the Guildford and Woolwich pub bombings were sensationally freed after confessions that formed the basis of their convictions were found to have been fabricated. Despite official foot-dragging, it soon became clear that the Birmingham case, also heavily dependent on confessions, would have to be reopened. The Devon and Cornwall police were again asked to conduct an inquiry, and this one, headed by the Chief Constable, John Evans, was a good deal more thorough than the first. They went back to the original police notebooks and quickly demonstrated that the confessions were forgeries, or unreliable, to use the legal jargon. Another reference to the Court of Appeal was inevitable, and this time round there was no doubt about the outcome. On Thursday, March the 14th, 1991, amid much official breastbeating, the convictions were finally quashed, and after 17 years in prison, the men walked free. The consequences were far-reaching. Within hours, the Home Secretary announced a royal commission to examine the criminal justice system. It led eventually to the setting up of the Criminal Cases Review Commission, which at the time of writing has resulted in the quashing of a further 500 convictions. It has also led to a sea change in the attitude of judges and juries towards police evidence. Despite the outcome of the Birmingham case, however, the upper reaches of the legal profession remained in denial. For years afterward, senior lawyers could be heard whispering that those whose convictions had been so spectacularly quashed were all really guilty. I lost count of the number of people who said to me, "I had dinner with Lord Justice so-and-so last night, and you should hear what he's saying about the Birmingham Six." Hopefully, however, a new generation of judges and lawyers will prove less gullible than their predecessors. The question remains, who was responsible for the bombings? Over the years, there have been several new inquiries by West Midlands police officers. These were, of course, hampered by their reluctance to disturb the official version of events. In 2018, however, a vociferous campaign by relatives of some of those who died in the bombings persuaded the authorities to reopen the long-postponed inquest. This resulted in yet another West Midlands police investigation, and this one appeared to be a great deal more rigorous than earlier ones. As with previous inquiries, I cooperated to the best of my ability, but made clear from the outset that I was unwilling to disclose confidential sources. This prompted the Chief Constable to apply for an order under the Terrorism Act, which would have obliged me to disclose unredacted notes of interviews with one of the surviving bombers. I declined, on the grounds that the interview had been obtained only as a result of absolute assurances of confidentiality. It's a cardinal principle of journalism in a democracy, enshrined in Article 10 of the European Convention on Human Rights, that journalists should not be forced to reveal their sources. The National Union of Journalists, recognising the significance of the issue, paid my legal costs. The application was heard at the Old Bailey, and in March 2022, I was vindicated. The judge refused to grant the order. Although the outcome was celebrated by fellow journalists and those concerned with the rights of a free press in a democracy, I readily understand that it will not seem so reasonable to those who lost loved ones or to the public in general. I would only ask that they bear in mind that, but for my investigation, the names of three of the four bombers might never have been known, and the six innocent men convicted of the bombings might have remained in prison to this day. Subsequent reforms to the criminal justice system would not have occurred. I was never under the illusion that I could bring the perpetrators to justice. My goal was simply to rescue the innocent. Could it happen again? In 1984, the Police and Criminal Evidence Act, which requires all interviews with suspects to be recorded and witnessed, makes it difficult for confessions to be fabricated in the way that they were in this and other notorious miscarriages of justice. Likewise, advances in forensic science, such as the discovery of DNA, have made wrongful convictions less likely. One can, however, just about imagine a scenario involving a serious terrorist incident triggering a wave of public hysteria fanned by an irresponsible tabloid media and leading to the conviction of innocent people. At the time of writing, there are several people serving long prison sentences whose convictions hang only by the slenderest thread. This is the fifth edition and the ninth printing of Error of Judgment. I hope that it will continue to be read by all those who care about justice. I am glad to hear that it features on the reading list of some students of criminal law, but it ought to be of wider interest. At one level, it is the story of a nightmare that overtook the lives of six unfortunate men and their families. But it is also a tale of hope, an account of how it is possible, in the teeth of great odds, for a just cause to triumph. Chris Mullin, February 2024.
Chapter 1. No one in Birmingham will ever forget the evening of Thursday, the 21st of November, 1974. Ian Cropper certainly won't. He was the telephonist on duty at the Birmingham Post and Mail. At 8:11, he took a call from a man in a call box. First came the pips, and then a voice with an Irish accent said, "The code word is double X." The man's voice was calm and clear. He went on, "There is a bomb planted in the rotunda, and there is a bomb in New Street." There was a slight hesitation, and he added quickly, "At the tax office." Then the line went dead. Cropper scribbled a note and then rang the information room at Lloyd House, headquarters of the West Midlands Police. The news hardly came as a surprise. IRA bombs had been going off for months in and around Birmingham. An alert was immediately flashed to all policemen in the area. Police Constable Brian Yates was one of the first on the scene. He was on foot patrol in New Street at about 8:15 when a message came over his radio that there was a bomb in the rotunda. The huge cylindrical monstrosity of glass and concrete which dominates the junction between New Street and St. Martin's Circus, and which had been bombed twice already that year. PC Yates raced down New Street to the rotunda. As he got there, he met two colleagues, PC Derek Bradbury and WPC Margaret Adams. Inside, At the reception, they found two police sergeants already organising a search of the building. It would not be easy. The rotunda was 20 stories high, and the bomber's message offered no clues. PC Yates, PC Bradbury, and WPC Adams were told to search the even-numbered floors. As they got into the lift, they felt the building tremble. From somewhere below, there came the sound of a huge explosion. They were too late. The bomb had exploded at 8:17, just 6 minutes after the warning. It had devastated the mulberry bush, a public house on two stories built into the base of the rotunda. At that moment, PC Rodney Hazelwood was racing towards the scene in his panda car. We were about 300 yards away, just cresting the hill, when there was the loudest thunderclap and rumbling and ground shock. Debris was coming down all over the road. It was like a volcano had exploded, people running and screaming. The mulberry bush had sort of exploded out onto the pavement. Rubble, half a staircase, glass, carpets, bar tops and furniture blown to bits, and injured people staggering out. Bus driver Anthony Gaynor was driving his number 90 bus around St. Martin's Circus at the moment the pub exploded. I had just passed the mulberry bush when I felt a loud bang. I thought at first someone had hit the bus in the back, but when I looked round I saw that a lot of windows on the bus had been blown in. Mr. Gaynor pulled his bus round the corner into New Street and went to help his passengers. The bus was a write-off. Maureen Carlin was in the mulberry bush with her fiancé, Ian MacDonald Lord, when the bomb went off. I didn't actually hear the explosion. The lights just sort of flickered and then went out, and I was being carried through the air. Ian said afterwards, "I knew immediately what it was, and even before I landed I was shouting, 'Bastards!'" He was referring to the IRA. PC Hazelwood reached the scene to find PC Bradbury and WPC Adams already there. They began moving the injured out of the devastated pub and into St. Martin's Circus. The bomb seemed to have exploded in the centre of the pub near the stairway. The stairs had been blown away. The dead included John Rowlands, a 46-year-old electrician at the Rover Car Works, 56-year-old Stan Bodman, a former RAF fighter pilot, and Trevor Thrupp, a British rail guard at nearby New Street railway station. The bodies of two youths were recovered from under a pile of rubble and timber outside. They had apparently been passing the pub at the moment of the explosion. Forensic scientist Douglas Higgs later said that the explosion had been caused by between 25 and 30 pounds of explosive placed against the wall of a liquor storeroom not far from the rear entrance of the pub. The force of the blast had blown a hole 40 inches in diameter through the 10-inch-thick concrete floor. Mr. Higgs said he had recovered fragments of two Smith's Industries alarm clocks, a D-shackle, and a keyhole plate from a briefcase or suitcase, which, in his view, had contained the explosives. The explosion had been caused by two separate devices, probably in the same container. The explosion at the mulberry bush could be clearly heard in the tavern in the town, 300 yards up New Street. Unlike the mulberry bush, the tavern was situated below street level, with only a door opening out onto New Street. The clientele consisted almost entirely of young people. That night, there were over 100 youngsters crowded into the dimly lit bar. Barman John Boyle and Patrick Daly were on duty in the tavern. They heard the explosion, but they had no idea where it came from. Daly went down into the cellar, opened the door at the back of the pub, looked in the direction of the railway station from where the explosion seemed to have come. Seeing nothing unusual, he returned to the bar. Boyle, meanwhile, had gone to the front doorway to check for suspicious packages. Finding nothing, he also returned to the bar. Minutes later, everything went black. The building shook and the air was thick with dust. Boyle described it. There was an almighty blast, and there were screams and shouts from everywhere. The ceiling fell in and the bar blew back at me. It was just a screaming mass of people. I saw one man with the side of his head blown off. Daly said afterwards. There was a big flash and I was surrounded by darkness. I was knocked to the floor, and the next thing I remember is removing debris from about my body and getting up. He escaped through a hole in the back wall. A young woman customer described what happened to her. I had come into the tavern a few minutes before. I went over to the bar with my girlfriend and was just about to buy a drink when there was a bang and everything started falling upon us. The lights went out and there was screaming and moaning everywhere. I flicked on my lighter and saw my friend next to me had lost her foot. I thought I was dead and that my spirit was just carrying on. Once again, PC Brian Yates was among the first on the scene. After the explosion at the mulberry bush, he had rushed out of the rotunda and run up the left-hand side of New Street, yelling at people to cross to the other side. As he reached the entrance to the tavern, the bomb exploded, throwing him backwards into a bus shelter. Shaken but uninjured, he picked himself up and went back to the tavern. There was smoke coming from the entrance, and the steps leading down into the pub were blocked with debris. PC Yates scrambled over the debris and down into the pub. It was pitch dark, and the air was thick with dust. He switched on his torch and could see people staggering about, their clothes blasted from their bodies. There was screaming, and people were calling to each other in the blackness. By the time Yates had made his way to the doorway, a number of passers-by had gathered. He asked them to help clear the rubble from the stairs so that those who were still able to walk could get out. Then he climbed back into the darkness to search for the injured. He was followed into the ruin by Police Inspector Baden Skitt. It was so dark that they could only locate survivors by feeling under the rubble. PC Yates found two girls trapped by fallen masonry beneath the stairs. He dragged them clear and continued searching. In one corner, he found three bodies stacked one on top of the other. He pulled a man out of the debris who had lost the back of his skull and the lower part of both legs. The people who were obviously dead were left, and the living were dragged clear. I tried to keep count of the dead, but gave up after the fifth. PC Yates stayed in the ruined pub until the last of the retrievable bodies had been recovered, while Inspector Skitt climbed back into New Street to take charge of the rescue operation. Although in a state of shock, some of those who had survived the blast stayed to help PC Yates search the ruin. As they worked, masonry showered down on them. Outside in the street, ambulances were ferrying the injured to hospital. Taxi drivers from the cab rank at nearby New Street rushed to offer their services. At Birmingham's General Hospital, 50 doctors and 180 nurses worked flat out to cope with the injured. One surgeon said, "Go to the casualty ward and you could be forgiven for thinking that roast beef was cooking. The smell of burns was still there long after these people had been removed. You want to put drips on an arm and it isn't there. You look for a leg and there isn't one." Forensic scientist Donald Lidston later testified that the explosion at the tavern in the town had been caused by about 30 pounds of blasting explosive wired to two clocks. The bomb had been placed in a corner at the furthest point from the bar, on the right-hand side of the staircase as you entered the pub from New Street. As with the mulberry bush, the explosion had blown a hole in the 10-inch concrete floor, about 3 feet by 3 feet six in diameter. Among the parts of the bomb recovered from the debris were fragments of two General Time of Scotland alarm clocks, a 4.5-volt ever-ready battery, a Phillips head screw, and two sets of D-shackles from the handles of a holdall or briefcase that had apparently contained the bomb. There was a third bomb that night. It was discovered at around 9:15, an hour after the other bombs had exploded, by Alfred Meeks, a caretaker with General Accident Insurance Company. Mr. Meeks had been for a drink in the Ivy Bush pub in Hagley Road and was returning to his flat on the top floor of the insurance offices. Access to the flat was through a door at the back of the building. As he went to open the door, he noticed two parcels in plain white plastic bags about a foot away. They had not been there when he left for the pub at around 7:30. He bent down and touched the top bag and felt something hard and flat inside. Then he rang the police. The Hagley Road bomb was the subject of a controlled explosion. It was later said to have consisted of 13.5 pounds of an explosive known as Eversoft Frangex, made by Irish Industrial Explosives Limited of Enfield in the Irish Republic. It cannot be legally imported into Britain. The explosives were said to be divided into two packages, to each of which was taped a detonator mechanism consisting of a Smith's alarm clock, an Ever-Ready 126 battery, a light bulb, and a Phillips head screw with the point broken off. The Phillips head screw was to prove to be the bomber's trademark. It was inserted into the face of the clock and protruded about an inch, a dangerous practice since it risked causing a short circuit and could have resulted in a premature explosion. Forensic evidence later showed that the Hagley Road bomb contained similar ingredients and was of a similar construction to both the bombs that went off in Birmingham that evening. It also bore a marked similarity to seven other bombs and incendiary devices placed at premises in Birmingham, Wolverhampton and Coventry in the 16 days before the pub bombings. Donald Lidston later told a court that in his view, all the bombs were the work of the same team. There were many reported sightings of the bombers that night. Roy Findon and his brother, Michael, were walking up New Street minutes before the bombs exploded. They had just passed the rotunda when they saw two men in their 20s standing outside Lloyd's Bank. According to Michael, one of the men was carrying a parcel. As the brothers approached, they saw two policemen coming towards them, checking shop doorways. The policeman disappeared briefly into a deep shop entrance, and the two men ran off in the direction of New Street Station. The brothers then boarded a number 33 bus, and as they took their seats on the top deck, there was a huge explosion. That was the mulberry bush going up. George and Edna Pugh also saw a man acting suspiciously. They were in the Odeon Cinema further up New Street watching The Planet of the Apes, sitting three rows from the back in the no-smoking area. Just before 8, after the film had been showing for some time, a man pushed past them and sat down on the right of Mrs. Pugh. As soon as he sat down, he took a hand-rolled cigarette, not from a packet, but from the breast pocket of his jacket, and started smoking. Mrs. Pugh said, "It was the fact that he was smoking in a no-smoking area which drew my attention to him." She went on, "During the 20 minutes he sat next to me, he smoked 3 or 4 cigarettes, more or less continually. I kept looking at him and noticed that he frequently looked at his wristwatch for the time. I thought this extremely strange, having apparently just come into the cinema. During the last 5 minutes prior to the first explosion, he sat looking at his watch all the time, and I felt uneasy about him." At the sound of the first explosion, the man's demeanour changed. He got up and walked casually to the end of the row, passing two other people on the way. Mrs. Pugh last saw him walking towards the exit. She later described the man to police as aged about 40 to 45 years and 5 feet 8 inches tall with dark hair. He was wearing a dark jacket and carrying what appeared to be a dark raincoat. Although Mrs. Pugh thought she would recognize the man if she saw him again, no trace of him was ever found. There was one other suspicious incident that night. A Mercedes sports car was seen speeding away down Stevenson Street, which runs off New Street between the Midland Hotel and the ramp leading into the station. A youth in his shirt sleeves was spread-eagled across the roof, and the car was chased by police officers, one of whom shouted to the driver of a passing bus, "Ram the bastard, he's a bomber." After about 25 yards, the youth fell off the roof and the car sped away. The incident was filmed by a camera crew and shown on television that night. For years, it has given rise to speculation that the men in the car were the real bombers. In fact, the occupants of the car were just people who had panicked, trying to flee the bomb zone. They were swiftly eliminated from police inquiries. The most promising lead came from Clifford Goodwin, a clerk in the booking office at New Street Station. He reported that shortly before the bombs exploded, three Irishmen had purchased return tickets to Belfast via the Lancashire port of Heysham. The train for Heysham had left at 7:55. Police at Heesham were put on the alert. It was some days before the full extent of the carnage was known. 21 people had died, and 162 were injured, later revised to 170, the biggest murder in British history. The Birmingham pub bombings came 7 weeks after pub bombings at Guildford and just 2 weeks after a pub in Woolwich had been blown up. The pub bombings seemed to indicate that the indiscriminate murder of civilians was now a permanent feature of IRA strategy. But the Guildford and Woolwich pubs had been blown up because many of their customers were British soldiers based at nearby barracks. This was not the case in Birmingham. Many of the Birmingham victims were Irish. One Irishman, John Riley, was called to identify the body of his 23-year-old son, Eugene, and was shown instead the body of another man, his other son, Desmond, whom he had believed to be working 200 miles away. Unknown to Mr. Riley, Desmond had returned unexpectedly to Birmingham to meet his brother for a drink at the tavern in the town. They both died. The bombings triggered off a wave of anti-Irish sentiment. Revenge attacks on Irish property began almost at once. Within hours, the Irish community centre at Digbeth was petrol bombed. A petrol bomb was thrown through the window of the College Arms at King Standing, a public house with many Irish customers. Lighted, petrol-soaked rags were thrown into lorries at an Irish-owned haulage firm at Smallheath. A fire was started at St. Gerard's Catholic School in Castle Vale. Revenge attacks were not confined to Birmingham. Irish-owned premises in London were also petrol-bombed. A pub and a tobacconist's shop in the London borough of Ealing were hit. So was a tobacconist's shop in Streatham, South London. At the British Leyland plant at Longbridge, there was a mass walkout by workers who took to the streets carrying makeshift placards saying, "Hang IRA bombers." The National Federation of Licensed Vittlers telegrammed the Home Secretary, Roy Jenkins, calling for the immediate reintroduction of the death penalty. At Liverpool and Manchester airports, workers refused to handle flights bound for Belfast or Dublin. In the House of Commons, Roy Jenkins promised tough measures against the IRA and its sympathisers. "Under the present circumstances," he said, "one could be justified in enabling the police and others to take exceptional measures in order to protect our people from indiscriminate killing." A week later, the Prevention of Terrorism Act was rushed through the House of Commons in a 17-hour emergency sitting. It passed through the House of Lords in only 2 minutes. The Act made membership of the IRA illegal and gave the police power to hold IRA suspects for up to 1 week without charge. It also gave police and immigration authorities power to expel or refuse entry to suspected terrorists and anyone suspected of harbouring them. A clause saying that the possession of documents relating to the IRA or any prescribed organisation was evidence of membership was dropped at the last moment. An editorial in The Guardian caught the mood of the hour. "A liberal society," it said, "cannot let its freedom and its concern for the rights of the individual be abused in order that it shall be torn to pieces. From now on, anybody who complains that he is being harassed by the police bomb squad will find a less than sympathetic audience." Chapter 2. The trail that led to the disaster in Birmingham began 7 days earlier outside the Central Telephone Exchange in Greyfriars Lane, Coventry. It was there, on the evening of the 14th of November 1974, that a young Irishman named James McDade blew himself to smithereens while planting a bomb. Another young Irishman, Ray McLaughlin, was arrested running away from the scene. McDade's thumbprint, the only clue to his identity, was said to match that on an incendiary device found the previous week at the premises of Gydex Limited, an office equipment manufacturer in Constitution Hill, Birmingham. Forensic evidence showed that the ingredients of McDade's bomb included a General Time of Scotland alarm clock, an ever-ready battery, and a socket for the warning bulb. Similar items were found in 9 other explosive or incendiary devices planted in and around Birmingham that month, including the bombs which 7 days later devastated the tavern in the town and the mulberry bush. 2 days after McDade's death, tributes began appearing in Republican newspapers in Ireland. One read, "James McDade, Lieutenant, Birmingham Battalion, killed in action." James McDade was born in the Ardoyne district of Belfast, a tiny Catholic enclave surrounded by the Protestant strongholds of Cliftonville, Heathfield, Lower Park Road and the Crumlin Road. Ardoyne was a village until the 1870s. It grew up around the textile mills that were almost the sole source of employment. The mill owners built the houses, and if a worker lost his job, he also lost his house. With the decline of the textile industry, the mills began to close. By the mid-1980s, they were all derelict, and more than half the population was out of work. It had been that way for 2 generations. For many, the only hope of work was to emigrate to England, and almost every family in Ardoyne had relatives in England. There was no way a young man brought up in Ardoyne could remain neutral. Whenever Cliftonville football team played at home, gangs of Protestant youths would descend on Ardoyne, smashing windows and shouting abuse. Catholic women and children would barricade themselves indoors while their men stood guard outside with sticks. Every 12th of July, on the anniversary of the Battle of the Boyne, a Protestant band would march to the Catholic Chapel of the Sacred Heart on the corner of Glenview and Parkview Roads and stand outside playing loud loyalist tunes. When Catholic children threw stones, the Royal Ulster Constabulary would give chase, shouting, "Get indoors, you Fenian scum!" It was to get him away from this that James McDade's mother encouraged him to go to England in search of work. McDade arrived in Birmingham in 1968 and lodged with Jerry Hunter and his wife in their back-to-back house in Aston. Hunter was also a refugee from Ardoyne, and had known McDade since they were at St. Gabriel's Secondary School together. He was a short, quick-tempered youth who had come to Birmingham in 1963, at the age of 17, and collected a couple of minor convictions, one for being a passenger in a stolen car, and the other for being involved in a brawl. Soon, however, he settled down, married a Birmingham girl, Sandra, and found work as an industrial painter. It was through the Hunters that McDade met his future wife, Jackie. McDade stayed with the Hunters for about 9 months. It was an unhappy arrangement, since he was given to drinking and argument. Eventually, after a fight with Jerry, he left. Although they were never again close friends, the Hunters continued to see McDade and his wife. Sandra last saw McDade at his brother's wedding party in August 1974. It was memorable because there was another row, and McDade stormed off, leaving Jackie to make her own way home. Jerry Hunter last saw McDade in late September, when the two men worked on a contract for Carness and Pearson, a firm of industrial painters in Handsworth. 6 weeks later, McDade blew himself up. McDade found other friends in Birmingham from his school days in Ardoyne. Billy Power was one of these. Power had emigrated to England in 1963 to escape unemployment in Belfast. His father had been a sergeant major in the British Army, and 5 of his 6 brothers and sisters had come to live in England. He had known McDade since they were together at the Holy Cross Primary School in Ardoyne. Billy Power was a gentle, soft-spoken young man. He was never much of a worker. As a boy, he had been sent to an approved school, for truancy. For years, he had drifted in and out of work, first as a labourer on building sites in London, and later as an industrial painter in Birmingham, sometimes working with McDade and Jerry Hunter. When he wasn't working, he would get up late and spend the afternoon watching the racing on television. He was an obsessive gambler, always nipping in and out of betting shops to lay money on horses. 2 years after coming to Birmingham, he met Nora, a girl from Cork. They rented a room in Handsworth and lived together. Nora became pregnant, and they talked about getting married. 3 times they arranged to marry, and 3 times Nora backed down. When at last they did marry, at a church in Aston, they already had one child, and there was another on the way. On the day of the wedding, they didn't have the price of a drink between them. Billy went to a betting shop, and Nora went home and changed the baby's nappy. Even after the second child arrived, they were still living in the single room in Handsworth. Then, in 1968, they were allocated an old council house in Aston. It had no bathroom and the toilet was outside, but it was a step up in the world. 5 years later, in 1973, they moved to a modern council house in Cranwell Grove, Erdington. By this time, they had four children. Billy was still drifting in and out of work, but he had his good points. He loved his children, and if he had a win on the horses, he always handed most of the money to Nora. Paddy Hill was another of McDade's friends from Ardoyne. Hill was born in the hospital next to the jail on the Crumlin Road. His father had worked for a Belfast engineering firm. According to Hill, he was sacked when he was discovered to be a Roman Catholic. Like McDade and Power, Hill was also a graduate of the Holy Cross Primary School. He was a couple of years older than McDade and remembers walking young Jamesy home from school. In February 1960, Hill's father went to Birmingham in search of work. Hill, his mother, three brothers and a sister followed 6 months later. Paddy Hill was short, stocky and tough. He had a deep scar leading down from the left-hand side of his mouth, a memento of his turbulent early years in Birmingham. By 1970, he had collected 17 convictions, mainly for brawling, but also for breaking and entering. In 1962, he served 3 months' detention for safe-breaking, and in 1970, he served 13 months in prison for stabbing three nightclub bouncers in a fight. His appearance might have been considered menacing, but for a ready smile and a devilish sense of humour. Hill, too, drifted in and out of work. Like McDade, Power and Hunter, he had worked as an industrial painter. He also did a bit of painting for nuns at the local convent. Hill says he never became a close friend of McDade's in Birmingham. He estimates that they only met a half dozen times in the 7 years before McDade blew himself up. By the time of his death, McDade was a popular figure in Birmingham's Irish clubs and pubs. By all accounts, he had a fine singing voice. His drinking habits, however, led to trouble at home. For some time, McDade, his wife and young child lived with his mother-in-law, but she eventually evicted them, and about a year before McDade's death, they went to stay with Billy and Nora Power in their new council house at Erdington. Jackie, McDade's wife, was expecting their second child. "I felt sorry for Jackie," says Nora Power. "I think Jamesy knocked her about a bit." The McDade stayed several weeks with Billy Power and his family. Nora remembers clearly what brought about their departure. "One day Jamesy asked if Billy had a gun. Billy was shocked. I told Billy they had to go and they left soon after." Nora Power never saw James McDade again, but a few days before he blew himself up, she saw a photo-fit picture of a man police wanted in connection with the latest outbreak of bombings in Birmingham. "I said to Billy, 'That's Jamesy.' Billy said, 'Don't be so bloody stupid.'" Those who knew McDade say that he was not obvious IRA material. When he first came to Birmingham, he had such a baby face that he had to carry his birth certificate with him in order to get served in pubs. In the early years, at least, he showed no interest in Republican politics. The turning point seems to have come in December 1971, when his brother Jerry, who had stayed in Ireland and joined the Belfast Brigade of the IRA, was shot dead by British paratroopers during a raid on a Republican club. Even so, most of those who knew McDade claim not to have connected him with the bombs that were going off all over Birmingham throughout 1973 and 1974. Sandra and Jerry Hunter both say they were shocked by his death. "My reaction was, if that's what the IRA are recruiting, they're wasting their time," says Sandra. Someone else who knew McDade said, "He was a very nervous fellow. I couldn't believe it when I heard he was in the IRA. I thought to myself, bloody hell, they must be hard up for recruits." Only Billy Power conceded that there were any grounds for suspicion. We'd be having a pint and Jamesy would say he had to go somewhere. We used to laugh and say as soon as Jamesy gets a bit of money, he prefers to drink on his own. It didn't stick out a mile. Only when you look back. Chapter 3. A few days after McDade's death, funeral notices began to circulate in Irish pubs and clubs in Birmingham. They were headed Lieutenant James McDade and read, "On November the 21st at 3:30, the remains of our comrade, James McDade, will be escorted from Coventry to Birmingham and on to Belfast. We consider it the duty of all Irish people to be present at Coventry mortuary. The coffin will be draped in the tricolour that covered the coffin of Michael Gochan, who died on hunger strike. Transport will be available for mourners." The Birmingham branch of Sinn Féin was determined that McDade should have a hero's funeral. The government and the West Midlands police were equally determined that he should not. Home Secretary Roy Jenkins assured the House of Commons that Sinn Féin supporters would not be allowed to escort the coffin to Birmingham's Elmden Airport. "Such a demonstration," said Mr. Jenkins, "affronts the tolerance of long-suffering people." The Public Order Act was invoked to ban the procession. Since the road between Coventry and the airport passed through the territory of three different local authorities, Coventry, Solihull and Birmingham, each had to call an emergency council meeting to bring the act into operation. All police leave was cancelled, and 1,300 policemen were drafted to line the route to the airport, and many more were on duty in Coventry and Birmingham in case of reprisal bombings. In death, James McDade was far more trouble to the British authorities than he had ever been in life. It was Jerry Hunter's idea to go to Belfast for the funeral. He suggested it to his friends Johnny Walker and Richard McIlkenny over a lunchtime drink at the Crossways pub in Erdington after McDade's death. Walker and McIlkenny were a good deal older than Hunter. Both had large families. Walker had six daughters and a son. McIlkenny, five daughters and a son. Both had steady jobs at Garrington's forging and presswork factory at Witten. Walker was a crane driver in the maintenance section, McIlkenny a millwright. Everyone who knew Johnny Walker agreed that he was one of the nicest men you could hope to meet. He was a tall, balding man whose white hair made him look much older than his 39 years. He was popular with the neighbours, sociable, but not a big drinker. He worked hard to keep his family, sometimes 7 days a week. Thomas Watt, one of his workmates, who would eventually give evidence against him, says today, "Johnny Walker was one of the kindest men I knew. He was very popular at work and always the first to help anyone in trouble. If a worker was off sick for a few weeks, Walker would arrange a collection for him, and it made no difference whether the man was Irish, English, or any other nationality." Walker was born and bred in Londonderry. He had lived in England since he was 17. Despite being born a Catholic, he did not come from a particularly Republican background. His brother, Eddie, was a sergeant major in the British Army, and Walker had served 2 years national service. He went back to Ireland only two or three times in 20 years. What seemed to have opened his eyes to the troubles in Ireland was the death of his father in 1972. Walker went to Derry for the funeral. His family lived in the Bogside, where 6 months before, British soldiers had shot dead 13 unarmed civilians in what became known as Bloody Sunday. The visit to Derry was an eye-opener. The Catholic estates were under siege. On one occasion, when Walker went out with his brother-in-law, they had to take cover from a shootout between the British Army and the IRA. Walker's father had had a bad chest and, shortly before his death, had been tear-gassed by British soldiers. Walker believed the tear gas had helped to kill his father. One of his daughters recalled that he sometimes said, "The British killed my father." When he returned to Birmingham, he took with him, as a souvenir, a plastic bullet fired by British soldiers at Catholic civilians. From that time on, Walker was an ardent Republican. He started organising raffles and totes for the families of internees in Northern Ireland. He and Richard McElkenny would sell the tickets at work, in the Crossways pub, and at the King Standing Ex-Servicemen's Club. Jerry Hunter and Paddy Hill also helped to sell tickets. At first, Jerry Hunter was treasurer, but Walker took over in the summer of 1973. The raffles made about £8 a week profit. Walker kept scrupulous records and handed the proceeds over to a workmate, Mick Murray, who sent it to the Prisoners' Dependence Relief Fund at Sinn Féin headquarters at Kevin Street in Dublin. Murray also helped to provide the prizes, which his wife purchased at a discount warehouse. These included table lamps, teddy bears, cutlery, ornamental clocks, alarm clocks, and watches, from which, in due course, sinister inferences would be drawn. Walker was not a member of the IRA, which was legal at that time, or of Sinn Féin, but many of his friends and acquaintances were. This began to be the subject of rows with his wife, Teresa. Once they went to a Sinn Féin social at the White Horse pub in Neachels. Jamesy McDade was singing, and many of those present were IRA members. Teresa said she would never go there again, and that he ought not to either. Walker had known McDade for 2 years. McDade had sometimes helped out with the raffles, but Walker didn't know him well. Had his friends not been going, Walker would not have gone to the funeral. When he got home that evening in November and said that he was going to McDade's funeral, Teresa was angry. Why waste money on a trip to Ireland, especially so near to Christmas? And for what? As far as she was concerned, Jamesy McDade had got what was coming to him. Richard McElkenny and his wife Kate were both natives of Ardoyne. Although at 41 he was much older than McDade, he had known the McDade family all his life. After McDade's death, Kate looked after his youngest child for a few days before the funeral. Like all natives of Ardoyne, Richard McElkenny and his wife were staunch Republicans. Two of Richard's brothers, Anthony and Ambrose, were interned in Ireland, and so was one of Kate's cousins. Richard worked hard organising raffles, totes and dances among the Irish community in Birmingham to raise money for the families of internees. He was also in the habit of buying half a dozen copies of the Sinn Féin paper, Republican News, and distributing them to friends. He was not, however, a member of Sinn Féin. When Jerry Hunter suggested going to Belfast for the funeral, both Walker and McElkenny expressed interest, but no definite arrangement was made. As yet, it was unclear when the funeral would be held, since McDade's remains were still in police custody at the mortuary in Coventry. The next day, Sunday the 17th of November, Jerry Hunter and Johnny Walker met Billy Power at a bus stop in King's Standing. Power was with his brother, Tony, and the four men repaired to the nearby Fisher and Ludlow Social Club for a drink. Hunter asked Power if he was going to the funeral, and said it would look good if all McDade's friends went. Power replied that he would go if he could find a few days' casual work to pay the fare. Next day, his plans for casual work having fallen through, Billy told his wife Nora that he would not be going to the funeral. Nora offered to help out. She was owed Social Security money, and if she could get it in time, she told Billy he was welcome to borrow it. Nora says it was she who encouraged him to go. He'd got stuck to the house, not working, just a few casuals here and there. I blame myself. If I had said don't go, he never would have gone that night. On Tuesday the 19th of November, Billy Power went to the Social Security office and asked for the money owed to his wife. He was told that it would be forwarded to her. Still more or less penniless, he went in search of Jerry Hunter. He called at Hunter's house in Worley Way, Erdington, but Hunter was not there. He looked in at the Crossways, but there was still no sign of Hunter. Leaving the Crossways, he ran into Richard McElkenny, who said that he understood that a mass was being arranged for McDade instead of a collection. Hunter, meanwhile, had gone with Walker to St. Chad's Roman Catholic Cathedral to buy mass cards to take to Belfast in memory of the dead man. They bought a dozen and had them signed by McDade's friends at the Crossways. Next day they returned and bought more, about 20 in all. On Wednesday, the 20th of November, Power called at Hunter's house just after midday, and they went to the Crossways for a drink. There they met Walker and some other friends and discussed arrangements for going to the funeral. The main topic of conversation was how Power and Hunter could raise money for the fair. Hunter had been out of work for 7 weeks, and like Power, he was broke. After about 15 minutes, Walker left for work. He was on the afternoon shift. Hunter and Power stayed on until closing time. That evening, they heard that McDade's remains would be released from the Coventry mortuary the following day and flown to Ireland. It therefore seemed likely that the funeral would be on Friday. When he got home, Billy Power's wife, Nora, told him that her brother Eddie would lend him the fare to Belfast. He would be going to the funeral after all. At the time, it seemed a stroke of luck. Looking back, it was the greatest disaster of his life. At around 11 o'clock on Thursday, the 21st of November, 1974, Billy Power again went round to Jerry Hunter's house to tell him the good news, that he was going to the funeral. Hunter had still not raised the fare, but thought he might be able to borrow it from Johnny Walker. They called round at Walker's house and found him sorting out the mass cards before taking them up to the church to be countersigned by the priest. On their way to the church, they called back at Hunter's house to pick up two more mass cards, one for Power and one for Hunter. Then they went to the Church of St. Margaret's and St. Mary's on Perry Common Road. The parish priest, Father Ryan, was out, so they left the cards with the housekeeper and said they would call back at 5 o'clock. Outside the church, Walker took leave of them, saying he had to collect the wages he was owed from work. He needed the money to pay his fare to Belfast. As he left, Walker promised that he and the others would try and make up Jerry Hunter's fare between them. Having nothing to do, Hunter and Power decided to call on Hunter's cousin, Seamus McLaughlin, at Holland Road, Aston, where McDade's widow, Jackie, was staying. They arrived at Holland Road to find the house crowded with people come to offer condolences to Jackie McDade. Sandra Hunter and Nora Power were there, and so was Richard McElkenny's wife, Kate, and McLaughlin's wife, Mary. Hunter and Power were shown into a room at the back of the house with the wives. They may have been hoping for a lift to Coventry, but since there was no room in the car leaving from Holland Road, they decided to go down to the Irish Community Centre at Digbeth, where Sinn Féin was supposed to be laying on coaches. Sandra Hunter and Kate McElkenny walked with them to the end of the road. Jerry Hunter and Billy Power caught a bus into town. Kate McElkenny went home, and Sandra Hunter went to collect her children from the Hastings Road Infant School. Hunter and Power arrived at the Irish Centre in Digbeth, only to find that the free transport to Coventry had been cancelled. The police, however, were much in evidence, standing in pairs on every corner. Since they didn't have the money for a bus fare to Coventry, let alone to Ireland, they decided to go to a pub, where they had just enough money for a light and bitter each. Later, they were to reflect that had they had the price of the bus fare to Coventry, they could not have got back to Birmingham in time to catch the train for Ireland. In the pub, they got talking to a couple of Irishmen, who bought them each another drink. Then, at Power's suggestion, they called in at a nearby betting shop, where he put his last 30 pence on a pair of greyhounds called Paul's Pride and Blue Bass. Power was lucky. He won £5.50. He placed one more bet and lost. Then they called in at another bookmaker's further up Digbeth, where Power placed a couple more unsuccessful bets. This left him with about £4, which he offered to split with Hunter, but Hunter refused his share. By now it was about 3 o'clock, and they both went their separate ways home. Before parting, they agreed to meet at New Street Station in time to catch the 6:55 train for Heysham and the ferry to Belfast. After leaving Hunter and Power outside the church, Walker called in at the Crossways, where he ran into Richard McElkenny. Walker told McElkenny that the funeral was to be the next day in Belfast, and that he was definitely going. McElkenny said that he would come too. First, however, they had to collect the wages owed them. Walker, who had been due to start an afternoon shift at 1:30, was about to phone the office, but McIlkenny pointed out that it would be shut. Instead, they decided to call in. When they arrived, McIlkenny stayed talking to the gateman while Walker went in and saw the foreman, Martin Murray. He was told to come back for his money at about 2:30. Walker also ran into a workmate, Dennis Turner, who had a sideline mending watches. Turner had several times mended watches and clocks for Walker and McIlkenny. He later estimated that over the previous 18 months, Walker had given him 3 or 4 clocks or watches to repair, and that Dick McIlkenny had brought him 2 alarm clocks and several watches. On this occasion, he had just repaired a wristwatch for Walker, and he told him it was ready for collection. Walker reached in his bag and produced an alarm clock with a broken spring, which he asked Turner to repair. Much significance would later be attached to Walker's association with clocks. Walker and McIlkenny then walked down to the nearby Yew Tree pub and had a couple of pints of Guinness before going back for their money. When they got back, they again saw the shift foreman, Martin Murray, and the shop foreman, Bob O'Dwyer. They told them they were going to the funeral of a friend in Belfast, collected their money, and departed. Both Walker and McIlkenny insist that apart from the two foremen, the watchmender, and the gatekeeper, they spoke to no one else during their short visits to their workplace. However, another workmate, Tom Watt, later testified that he met Walker in the locker room. Watt said that he already knew Walker was going to McDade's funeral because Walker had told him the previous day. In the locker room, according to Watt, Walker said he was going to Belfast and had given him the key to the tea cupboard. The conversation would be of no significance except that Watt added that Walker warned him not to go out that night. I said why, and he said, that's enough. Watt claimed that this was only the latest of several such warnings given him by Walker, and that these had usually been followed by explosions. Walker denies that he ever said anything of the sort. As for the conversation on the day of the bombing, he denies he even met Watt. Much was made of Watt's evidence in court, and it is a subject to which we shall return. Having got their money, Walker and McIlkenny then went to call on Eddie Loosley, another regular at the Crossways and a workmate at Garrington's. Walker borrowed a black tie from Loosley. Then he and McIlkenny separated and went back to their respective homes. Before parting, they agreed that McIlkenny should call at Walker's house at about 6 o'clock. They would then call for Jerry Hunter and make their way to New Street Station in time to catch the 6:55 to Heysham. Chapter 4. Until the last minute, Paddy Hill did not know whether he would make it. Like Jerry Hunter and Billy Power, he was flat broke. He had not worked for the best part of a year, and he supported his wife and 6 children on £60 a week social security money. Hill had seen Hunter 2 days after McDade's death, and said he was hoping to go to Belfast for the funeral. Although he had been at primary school with McDade, Hill had not been a close friend. Nevertheless, he was tempted by the prospect of a trip to Belfast. An 80-year-old aunt had just had a stroke and was not expected to live. Hill had promised to visit her before Christmas. McDade's funeral provided an opportunity and also offered the prospect of some congenial company. On Tuesday, the 19th of November, Hill learned that his aunt had taken a turn for the worse, and he made up his mind to go. Money remained a problem, however. Thursday, the 21st of November, dawned, and he was still no nearer raising the money. He spent most of the day at home with his wife and 3 of his children, and by 3:30 he was getting desperate. Taking his 2-year-old son, Sean, with him, Hill went to visit Johnny Walker at Perry Common. The journey from Hill's home at King Standing involved 2 buses and took about 30 minutes. Hill planned to ask Walker if he could borrow the raffle money to pay his fare to Belfast. Walker, however, said he had nothing to lend. He had sent the proceeds from the raffle to the Prisoner's Dependence Fund the previous week. On leaving Walker's house, Hill telephoned his wife, Pat, from a call box at the end of the street.
She said she would lend him £2 from her money box, the key to which was in the custody of a family friend, Rose Murphy. The reason for Mrs. Murphy's custody of the key to the money box remains obscure. Hill says that this was the first he knew of it. Pat Hill also suggested that he might try to raise a loan from Sister Bridget, a nun at the Little Sisters of the Assumption convent at Old Oscott Hill, a 5-minute walk from home. Sister Bridget had known the Hill family for about 2 years and helped them out on several occasions. She was not in when Hill phoned. He was told to call at the convent at 6 o'clock. Hill then called at Rose Murphy's house, collected the key to his wife's money box and went home. He arrived home around 5 o'clock, shaved, bathed, and put a few clothes in a small blue suitcase. He went to the convent where Sister Bridget lent him £15, which, added to the £2 from his wife's money box, gave him more than enough for the £15 return ticket to Belfast. At 5 o'clock, Johnny Walker went to collect the mass cards from Father Ryan. When he got back, one of his daughters made him scrambled eggs. He sent his son, Sean, round to Jerry Hunter's to collect a maroon holdall, which Hunter had borrowed for his father's funeral 7 weeks earlier. The zip had broken, and Sandra Hunter mended it. When Sean returned with the holdall, two of Walker's daughters, Bernadette and Veronica, packed him a few clothes, ham sandwiches and Granny Smith apples for the journey. Dick McElkenny called for Walker, as arranged, at about 6 o'clock. He brought with him Hughie Callahan, another regular from the Crossways. Hughie Callahan, an unemployed labourer, lived with his wife and 16-year-old daughter in a council house in Erdington. He was 44 years old and had lived in Birmingham since 1947. Like McElkenny, Hunter, Power and Hill, he was born in Ardoyne. As a boy, he had known the McDade family, and over the last 2 years he had become acquainted with Jamesy, but did not know him well. Callahan's wife, Eileen, describes Hughie as a timid, inoffensive man with no political beliefs. He suffered from ulcers and had not been in regular work for 3 years. The day of the disaster was also Eileen's birthday. Hughie Callahan went to collect his £17.20 social security money from the post office at Stockland Green. He'd arranged to meet Eileen near the post office later that morning to hand over the money which she needed for the family's housekeeping. Hughie, however, needed the money to repay a debt, so when he met Eileen, he told her that the post office would not pay out the money until the afternoon. He was owed £12 for casual work he had picked up from a man he had met in Yates's wine lodge in Corporation Street. He would go to Yates's that evening, collect the money he was owed, and take it home to his wife, who would be none the wiser. That, at least, was the plan. After leaving his wife at Stockland Green, Callahan had gone for a drink at the Crossways. On the way, he met Jerry Hunter and Billy Power going to Seamus McLaughlin's house. They stood chatting for a few minutes, during which Hunter and Power mentioned that they were trying to raise the money to go to Belfast for McDade's funeral. Then they parted company. Walker and McElkenny were in the Crossways, but Callahan did not speak to them beyond passing the time of day. He stayed at the Crossways until closing time and consumed 3 or 4 pints of Guinness. After closing time, he strolled up to the King Standing Ex-Servicemen's Club, where he had a couple more Guinnesses. Then, reluctant to go home until he could pay his wife's housekeeping, he called at Richard McElkenny's house in Epsom Grove to repay a pound he owed. Callahan arrived at McElkenny's house shortly after 4 and found McElkenny getting ready for his trip to Belfast. He sat playing with McElkenny's children while Richard packed. Callahan had no intention of going to Ireland, but having nothing better to do, said he would come to New Street Station to see them off. Unlike Teresa Walker, Kate McElkenny was keen that her husband should go to Belfast. She was a cousin of James McDade and had been brought up in the same street as his family, but it wasn't only sympathy for the McDades that prompted her to encourage her husband to go. Richard usually went back every year and took 1 or 2 of the children with him. This was 1 year he hadn't been back to see his family, and I said, "Why don't you go?" Richard McElkenny says the funeral was not his main interest. "I thought I'd like to see my mother for a couple of days and be back on Sunday." Kate McElkenny arrived home from work at around 5 o'clock and set about helping her husband prepare for his journey. She drew up a shopping list of Irish foods which she wanted him to bring back: soda bread, potato bread, Irish sausages, vegetable rolls. She then called on a neighbour and asked to borrow a suitcase. It was a blue case with a zip fastener. She had borrowed it before when they went to Belfast for her father's funeral. Into the suitcase, Richard packed a new shirt, a tie, and the jacket of his new suit, still in its plastic wrapping. The trousers were with Sandra Hunter, who was turning up the legs for him. Shortly before 6, McElkenny and Callahan left a call for Johnny Walker, a walk of about 10 minutes. "See you on Sunday," McElkenny said to his wife as they left. He was never to return. Walker was waiting when McElkenny and Callahan arrived. One of Walker's daughters handed him the maroon holdall, and the three men set off down Enderby Road to the bus stop on Witton Lodge Road. On the way, they passed Paul Wickett, the son of Walker's next-door neighbour. Wickett later testified that the holdall Walker was carrying appeared to be so heavy that he stopped to change hands. He said he had called to Walker, but Walker had ignored him. At Witton Lodge Road, the three men caught a number 5 bus to Ridgeway. At Ridgeway, they got off and walked to Jerry Hunter's house in Worley Way. Hunter had with him a large overcoat left behind by a friend from Belfast who had once lodged with him, and which Hunter planned to return. He asked Walker to put it in his bag and tried to squeeze it in, at which point Sandra Hunter intervened. "Don't do that," she said, "you'll crease your shirts." She emptied the contents of Walker's bag onto the dining room table. There were sandwiches, the Granny Smith apples, 2 shirts, socks, a jacket, trousers, and a shaving kit. She then put the overcoat into the bag and tried to put the clothes and other things back on top, but they wouldn't fit, so the coat had to come out again. Since Hunter had no bag, he also gave Walker 2 pairs of socks and a shirt and asked him to put them in his case. In the confusion over the coat, however, the shirt was left behind. Richard McElkenny then asked Sandra if he had his trousers. She went to get them, then opened McElkenny's case. There was a Chelsea Girl carrier bag inside with his shaving gear in it. She moved it over so that she could lay the trousers flat. Johnny Walker then produced the mass cards for McDade. Sandra was neither Irish nor was she a Catholic, but she had known Jamesy on and off for 6 years. She signed, and the men went off. There were now 4 of them: Walker, McElkenny, Callahan, and Hunter. They set off from Jerry Hunter's house at about 6:30 to catch a bus into the centre of town. As they reached the Ridgeway, Hunter's 2 small sons caught them up and gave Hunter a pound note from his wife. At Ridgeway, they caught a bus into the city centre. As they were getting off, at Colmore Row near the cathedral, 3 girls tried to push their way onto the bus, and the driver ordered them to get to the back of the queue. From Colmore Row, they went across the churchyard, across Temple Row and down Needless Alley, the narrow passage which runs past the Windsor pub. They came into New Street, up the ramp into the shopping precinct above the station. As they hurried along, Hunter said, "I told Billy we'd meet him at 6:30. He'll think I'm not coming." Billy Power was first to arrive. He had been waiting at New Street since about 6:40. His only luggage was a brown paper bag containing a clean shirt and a pair of socks. He had scraped together the train fare by borrowing £10 from his brother-in-law and £4 from his wife, Nora. This, added to the £4 left over from his win on the dogs that afternoon, gave him enough for the return fare. After glancing around the station and seeing no familiar faces, he went to a cigarette kiosk and bought a packet of 20 Embassy tipped. As he walked away from the kiosk, he noticed a man staring at him. The Heysham train was due out at 6:55, and it occurred to Power that his friends might already be on board. He went back to the cigarette kiosk and bought a box of matches to get change for a platform ticket machine. He then bought a platform ticket and went to Platform 9 to search the train. The man whom he had noticed watching him now seemed to be following. Seeing no one he recognised, Power surrendered his platform ticket and went back to the station concourse. At 6:57, he was just about to give up and go home when he saw Walker, McIlkenny, Hunter and Callahan coming down the escalator. By now they were too late to catch the 6:55, or so they thought. Later they learned that the train had been delayed and did not in fact depart until 7:08. At the ticket office, Walker, McIlkenny and Power purchased return tickets to Belfast. Walker and McIlkenny each stumped up half the cost of a single ticket for Hunter. They then had the best part of an hour to kill until the next train at 7:55, so they decided to have a drink. By an eerie coincidence, Callahan suggested the mulberry bush in the rotunda, about 2 minutes' walk away. The beer was cheaper there, he said. Eventually, however, they opted for British Rail's Taurus bar at the end of the station concourse. All the seats in the Taurus were taken, and so they stood by a pillar near the doorway. There were several railway workers sitting at a table nearby, and a young couple near the bar. Two Jamaican girls were serving behind the bar. Callahan bought the first round. Jerry Hunter went out to a phone box to ring his mother in Belfast. Hunter's mother was not on the phone, so he rang a neighbour, Felix Doherty, and said he would ring back in 10 minutes if Doherty would arrange for his mother to be available by the phone. As he came back into the bar to rejoin the others, he noticed a man outside who appeared to be watching them through the plate glass window at the front. "There's a man outside staring at us," he said. The man was in his 40s, and Hunter speculated that he might be a policeman, to which Walker replied, "So what? We're not doing nothing." The police later said there were no officers on New Street Station at that time. The men later said they were in the bar from about 7:10 to 7:45. The timing is crucial, since it was later alleged that they went from there to plant the bombs in the tavern in the town and the mulberry bush. At first, according to the men, they were standing by the pillar. Later, when a table became vacant, they moved to a table on the left-hand side of the bar and sat down. The young couple near the bar seemed to be having a tiff. At one stage, the man walked off, leaving the girl in tears. After a few minutes, he came back, and they kissed and made up. The five Irishmen kept themselves amused watching this little cameo. After about 20 minutes, Johnny Walker bought another round, and Hunter went out to telephone Felix Doherty again. Doherty said that Hunter's mother was out, and so Hunter asked if he could arrange for them to be met at the boat. Doherty said he would ask a mutual friend, Diddler Dunlop, to meet them, and suggested Hunter ring back to confirm the arrangement. Hunter estimates it was about 7:40 by the time he got back from the second phone call. The train was due out in 15 minutes. They were just getting ready to leave the bar when Paddy Hill walked in. After collecting his money from Sister Bridget, Hill had taken two short bus rides to the Crossways pub at King's Landing. Landlord, Noel Walsh, later recalled that Hill, who was one of his regulars, arrived between 6:30 and 6:45. He was dressed smartly and was carrying his small blue suitcase. Hill told Walsh he was going to Ireland and jokingly asked for a couple of pounds. Hill had ordered a drink and then went next door to the library where there was a public telephone. From there, he called his wife, Pat, and told her that the nuns had come up with the money for his fare, and so he would be going to Belfast. He then went back to the Crossways and finished his drink. His suitcase was the subject of some amusement, and as he left, he told the landlord, Mr. Walsh, "You'll be sorry if I leave that here." Walsh later testified that he clearly understood this to be Hill's idea of a joke. He was always cracking jokes. And in any case, jokes about parcels left in pubs were all the rage at the time, though after that night they would never again seem funny. Walsh said he heard at least one such crack a day, and had heard Hill make similar remarks several times before. Hill left the Crossways at about 7:10. There were many witnesses to his departure. He tried unsuccessfully to cadge a loan from Ray Cook. Then he tried to cadge a lift into town from Tommy Jolly. Jolly excused himself on the grounds that he was driving his firm's lorry. Out in the car park, Hill met Brian Craven and Arthur Southall. He said he was going to catch the train to Ireland and was afraid he would miss it. They, too, refused to take him. Hill then crossed the road and caught a bus, number 42K, into town. He got off the bus at Dale End, a few minutes' walk from New Street Station. By the time he reached the Taurus Bar, it was after 7:45. The others were surprised to see Hill. No one had mentioned he was coming. "And where do you think you're going?" asked Johnny Walker. "I'm going with yous." "Where did you get the money?" "I tapped it off the nuns." "You what, Paddy?" "I'll make it up to them with a bit of decorating." Hill then went to the bar and was about to buy himself a drink when Richard McElkenny told him there was no time. Instead, he bought a packet of 20 Park Drive plain cigarettes and had a sip out of Billy Power's glass. Then they left the bar, and Hill went to buy a ticket. He walked away from the ticket office, leaving the ticket on the counter. The booking clerk called him back. The others didn't wait for Hill. Callahan bought himself another platform ticket, and they went through the barrier. At the men's shop, just inside the barrier, Walker and McElkenny bought cigarettes, and they then made their way to Platform 9. On the platform, Hunter gave Power, who had no overcoat, the coat he was carrying for his friend in Belfast. Hill caught up with them on the platform, and everyone except Callahan boarded the train. It pulled out within a minute, and Callahan stood on the platform waving them off. It was 7:55 on the evening of the 21st of November 1974. The pubs in the city centre were filling up, mostly with young people. By now, the bombs must already have been ticking. All the victims were in their place. Chapter 5. Jamesy McDade's remains left Coventry Mortuary at about 4 o'clock on a twilight November afternoon. He departed with a minimum of ceremony. In the mortuary chapel, two priests conducted a short funeral in defiance of a ban by the Archbishop of Birmingham. Mourners included McDade's 20-year-old widow, Jackie, and his 2-year-old son, Gerard. As the IRA notice had promised, the coffin was covered with the flag that had once adorned the coffin of the dead hunger striker, Michael Gochan. Gochan's brother, John, was among the mourners. So was Brendan McGill, national organiser of Sinn Féin in Britain, and George Lynch, Birmingham organiser. Outside, a crowd of about 300 Sinn Féin supporters faced a 3-deep police cordon. Nearby, a group of National Front supporters chanted anti-IRA slogans. The demonstrators were kept well back from the entrance to the mortuary. The badges on the police helmets twinkled in the television lights. Before the coffin emerged, police ordered the flag to be removed, and Brendan McGill addressed the crowd through a loud hailer. "In a few moments, the remains of Lieutenant James McDade will leave the mortuary. Please stay as orderly as possible. I want no trouble." As the coffin appeared, a lone bagpiper dressed in a kilt played a lament. The piper was later suspended by his employers, the car components firm Joseph Lucas, after threats from his workmates. The anti-IRA demonstrators began singing, "Go home, you bums," to the tune of Auld Lang Syne. Others chanted, "IRA out." A bottle, followed by several bags of flour, was hurled at the hearse, but there were no hits. The coffin was loaded quickly into the waiting hearse. The mourners clambered hastily into 3 waiting funeral cars, and then the little procession sped away, escorted by 4 police cars. As they moved off, scuffling broke out between the 2 groups of demonstrators, and there were several arrests. As the funeral cars sped past the anti-IRA demonstrators, one of the mourners was seen to make a V-sign. On arrival at Birmingham's Elmden Airport, McDade's coffin was loaded aboard a British Airways Viscount, scheduled to take off for Belfast at 6:30. The 22 mourners who were accompanying the remains to Belfast took their seats on the plane. Soon, however, it became apparent that all was not well. From Belfast, word came that airport workers would refuse to handle the coffin following threats of assassination from Protestant paramilitary groups. There was a delay while British Airways officials tried unsuccessfully to persuade the Belfast airport workers to change their minds. When this failed, the coffin was unloaded and the Sinn Féin mourners were transferred to a passenger lounge. Security was tight. 800 policemen surrounded the airport and the Sinn Féin mourners were kept well away from the public. There was a further delay when ground staff at Birmingham walked out after hearing that a bomb threat had been made against them. Eventually, the Viscount took off, without MacDade and his mourners. Brendan McGill went to negotiate with the pilot of an Aer Lingus flight bound for Dublin. The pilot agreed to take the coffin, and preparations were made for the Sinn Féin party to board. It was after 8 o'clock, and the atmosphere at the airport was tense. By now, the five Irishmen were speeding towards Crewe. At Crewe, they would have to change onto the London Heysham train. From Heysham, they would take the ferry for Belfast. British Rail guard, Rab Nawaz, remembered checking their tickets just after Stafford. He later described them as being in a jolly mood. One of them, he thought, was slightly drunk, but he could not be sure. He noticed that they had Irish accents. They reached Crewe at 8:50 and went into the buffet for a cup of tea. Paddy Hill bought a steak and kidney pie, which broke up while he was eating it, causing gravy to dribble over his hands. While the others were in the buffet, Jerry Hunter again went to telephone his mother's neighbour, Felix Doherty, to confirm that Diddler Dunlop would be waiting in his car to meet them when the ferry arrived in Belfast. Doherty confirmed the arrangement. The London Heysham train arrived on time at 9:15, and they boarded without incident. After seeing his friends off at New Street Station, Huey Callahan went back to the tourist bar to finish his drink. When he got there, however, he found that his glass had been cleared away. He decided to go on to Yates's wine lodge in search of the man who owed him £12.50. He left New Street Station by the front entrance, skirted the left-hand side of the bullring, and went into New Street. As he did so, he passed within 3 feet of the Mulberry Bush public house, which was by now crowded with customers, some of whom had only minutes to live. At Birmingham Airport, the Sinn Féin passengers were preparing to board the Aer Lingus flight for Dublin. Police and airport authorities heaved a sigh of relief that MacDade would shortly be off their hands. Assistant Chief Constable Maurice Buck was chatting to journalists when a policeman called him to one side and said that there was an important telephone call. When word that bombs had gone off reached the journalists, they scrambled for their cars and raced into town. In his haste, one reporter left a bag behind and triggered a bomb scare, which led to the evacuation of the airport buildings. Of the Sinn Féin supporters, only Birmingham organiser George Lynch knew what had happened. As they were about to board the plane, he was called to a telephone. It was his wife, Phyllis, ringing to say that she had got home safely from the Coventry mortuary. As she was speaking, news of the bombings flashed onto the television. She relayed the contents to her husband. Lynch went back to the airport lounge, and shortly afterwards they boarded the Aer Lingus Boeing 727 without his breathing a word to any of his colleagues. Through the aeroplane window, he watched as 6 policemen loaded MacDade's coffin into the cargo hold. Chief Superintendent Harry Robinson, head of West Midlands CID, was in his office at Lloyd House when news of the bombings came through. His deputy, Superintendent Pat Cooney, and Superintendent Andrew Crawford, head of Special Branch, were with him. It had been a long day, and the 3 men were looking forward to going home. Robinson was checking through some last-minute paperwork when the phone rang. Crawford answered. "There's been a bomb go off," he said. There had been a lot of bombs in Birmingham that year. Robinson thought his leg was being pulled. "I told you," he said, "as soon as I've finished this, I'm going home." Before Crawford had a chance to explain, the phone rang again. A second bomb had gone off. For a moment, Robinson still thought Crawford was joking, until he saw from Crawford's face that it was no joke. The 3 men raced for their cars. They were on the scene by 8:30. 9 miles away, at police headquarters in Walsall, Detective Superintendent George Reed was also thinking about going home for the night when the phone rang. It was his wife, Pat. There had been more bombings, she said. Big ones, many dead. It had just been on the TV. "See you when I see you," said Reed, replacing the receiver. And with that, he rounded up every available CID officer and set off for Birmingham. In his time, George Reed had handled some big cases, but this was to be his finest hour. At the airport, the Aer Lingus Boeing was still on the tarmac. On board, the Sinn Féin mourners and their fellow passengers waited impatiently for takeoff. Only George Lynch knew the reason for the latest delay. Through the plane windows, they could see policemen and officials scurrying back and forth. Eventually, special branch officers came on board and took away two Sinn Féin men, Michael Holden and John Higgins. They had not returned by the time the pilot was given the all-clear for takeoff, and the plane left without them. It was 9:15. Lynch kept his secret all the way to Dublin. The friends of James McDade would be among the last to learn of the terrible retribution that attended his departure. As the plane carrying McDade's remains took off, the five Irishmen were boarding the train for Heysham. They sat at a table in an almost empty compartment. Four of them sat round the table and one perched on the arm of the opposite seat. Jerry Hunter produced a pack of cards and they started playing Don, a popular card game in Birmingham's Irish pubs. The only other passengers in the compartment were Linda Jones, a market trader from Blackburn, and her mother. They were returning from a day's shopping spree in London. Linda Jones remembered the men getting in at Crewe. She later recalled that one of them, it must have been Paddy Hill, was shorter than the others. He was carrying a case, which, because of his height, he had difficulty putting on the luggage rack. Miss Jones noticed nothing about the men except they had Irish accents. They were still playing cards when she and her mother left the train at Preston. Soon after arriving at the scene of the bombings, Chief Superintendent Harry Robinson ordered a watch to be kept on all ports and airports. Telex messages went out from Lloyd House alerting police and port authorities around the country to be on the lookout for suspicious passengers travelling from Birmingham. When the booking clerk at New Street reported that he had sold return tickets to Belfast to a group of Irishmen not long before the explosions, the Birmingham police immediately contacted the British Transport Police at Heysham. Sergeant Alan Dickey took the call. Bombs had gone off in Birmingham, he was told. A number of people had been killed. A party of Irishmen were on their way from Birmingham New Street to Heysham. There was nothing necessarily to connect them with the bombings, but they should be questioned on arrival. The only train they could possibly be on was the Ulster Express from London Euston. It had three stops before arriving at Heysham, Crewe, Preston and Lancaster, and it was due in at 10:45. There was plenty of time to prepare. Dickey stationed a dog handler, Constable Gerald Baines, at the end of the platform so that no one could escape down the track. Another officer was deputed to board the train to make sure everyone got off. Special Branch Officer David Watson was stationed near the barrier, and the ticket collector, 64-year-old Arnold Taylor, was warned to be on the lookout for passengers with tickets issued at Birmingham New Street. The Ulster Express arrived on time. There were about 300 people on board, all bound for Ireland. Mr. Taylor looked carefully at each ticket. The returns he tore in half, keeping the used portion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.